Let's take a deep breath. Hold it in. Let it out slowly. Church, let your week fall away. Let this new beginning of the week just come to you as an empty, open canvas that you can just paint your love of the Lord on it and carry it with you all week. Let your trials and your tribulations fall away. Know that you have the ability to speak directly to the Lord through the Holy Spirit, through His Son Jesus, and to the Lord Almighty. Prepare your hearts, church. Prepare your minds as the flames come down the aisle, as our symbol of the Holy Spirit with us and within us, and bring the flame. I thought that since last week that I forgot Advent, and I'm going to talk about that in just a minute. But as you notice, the first week Advent candle has been burning. It's burned down. And today, last week was hope, and today we light the second Advent candle, the hope of love. Hope and love. Thank you, brother. And thanks to everybody for getting that out. I was really proud of you, church, last week. Not a single person came up to me and fussed at me for forgetting Advent. Did anybody else forget it? Amen and amen. Church, if you'll take your hymnal, and most of you know this, turn to page 881. There you will find the Apostles' Creed. As we prepare to start our worship, did any of y'all notice that Hiwassee College got sold? They sold Hiwassee College, and thankfully, it seems like they sold it for enough to remove all their debt. But it's interesting who it sold to. And I'm going to butcher this name. If Ursula was here, she could help me. But it's a body of Christians called Bruderhof, which means brother's house. And there are 3,000 members. They are Anabaptist. Do y'all know what that means? If you don't, it's okay. For years on it. If you're it's not anti-Baptist, A-N-A, Anabaptist. What they believe is that you must be baptized when you're old enough to recognize what it is that you're doing. That's the whole deal. There's 3,000 of them worldwide. They all live in communes. Hiwassee College will become home to about 250 of these folks. And they give up everything basically when they come in. They live together. They subsist together. And it's an interesting take. But I think if we would join in prayer for these folks, I don't know that I could do that. Thought about it. What do y'all think? Think we ought to start a commune? And anyway, that was good for Hiwassee, and it's been kind of out blowing in the wind for a long time, and I'm glad as a Hiawassee person, I'm glad to see that it's settled. Let's prepare ourselves for worship. Page 881, stand as you are able as we share together in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
All right, and if you all would remain standing and join us for our first hymn, it's on page 57, O for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. And we'll be doing verses 1 through 3.
Church, I know that more than once I've come in here and said, you know, your pastor's feeling a little different today. Why break a record? Amen? Your pastor's feeling a little different today. This week of study on the scripture and, you know, the church year and of course, COVID and the elections and I'm pooped. Any of y'all tired of all this? I mean physically tired too, not just mentally tired. And I got to say, and you know that I don't bring politics one side or the other into the pulpit. But I do know this, and some of us may disagree, and that's okay. It's okay if we disagree. My word is certainly not the last word in the matter. God's word is the last word in every matter, and the first if we are good followers. But I heard the other day that the president-elect basically begged us to give him 100 days with all of us wearing masks. I'm not a scientist. I don't know. But the scientists say that if we were all wearing them, at least we could keep the rate from escalating. So church, I'm just going to ask that you will prayerfully consider that mandate. And until the vaccine, I'm going to take it. I'll take it. If any of y'all are worried about it, I'll take it first, and you can watch me for 2 weeks to see if it kills me or whatever, or turns me into a third party candidate. I don't know what it is. But I'll take it, and I will take it so that all can see. Am I 100% certain of that? No, it'd be a pretty scary thing. It's going to be a scary thing for me to take that vaccine. How many of you still have the stars on your arms? Y'all remember that when it wasn't a star, but it was a scar, and it lasted forever. And you know what? What did we do? We just lined up. Crank, crank, and they cranked us out.
It worked, didn't it?
It sure seemed to. And I'm going to be in prayer that the ones coming out now will as well. Amen? So that's all I'm saying. I don't care who you vote for as long as you vote. I don't care who you follow as long as it's Christ first. Let's just try it. And I thank y'all for being such good stewards in here. I hate them. They fog up my glasses. I smell my own breath. Oh, anyway. That's all I got to say on that for today. But let me just say this. Let me just say this. We're going to go and we're going to, as body of Christ right now, we're going to lift our prayers up to the Lord. We're going to lift our praises up to the Lord. We're going to let him know that we can't even speak it, but we need his help during this time. Amen?
Amen.
Are there any unspokens this morning? Are there any that would like to share a praise request or a prayer? Yes, Vincent, way in the back.
My friend Jalen, who I've known since I was like really little, he's undergoing a heart transplant, and I just wanted to pray for him.
Galen?
Jalen.
With a J? Church, I don't know about y'all, but that sounds like a reason for us to pray together right now. And it's Jalen. Is that right? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. We will come back. Father God, Vincent wanted to share with us the name of his dear friend that he's known forever, that is this day undergoing a heart transplant. Father, I thank you for this young man, Jalen, and I thank you for this young man, Vincent, that loves you enough to reach out to his church for all of us to lift our voice in prayer for this young man. Father, I pray that the doctors are the best and that they are well aware. I pray that the nurses and the technicians are all fully aware and ready. I pray that the medications and those that sterilize the rooms and all of the above, Father, I'm praying that your presence just falls on every one of them so that this young man has the most connected team he could possibly have. Whether they know you or not, they know that something is going on in that room and they need to be at their best. Father, we're asking that not only is the surgery successful, but we're asking that it takes and the infection stays away. And this young man is able to continue his life thanks to someone that had enough love in themselves that they would donate a vital organ. Father, we ask this prayer and all that will follow today. And it's in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. And it's for his sake that we pray. And all God's children said, Amen. Do we have any others that would like to share? Yes, sir.
Lisa and her husband, Robert.
Yep. Lisa and Robert. Mr. Funk. Mr. Funk. Anything, anyone else, church? Does anyone else have a prayer that they like? Yes, sir.
Son-in-law, his mom had a stroke and also had some brain. They're going to get a brain specialist to help her out. Do you have any real
Right.
And she's been in and out of the hospital for quite a while. We could put a prayer in for her.
We would definitely do that. Yes, ma'am. He's at the top of my list up here. But I know that Susan needs him as well.
Oh, yeah.
And Jairus and Jessica. And Eric and Candace, all family members. And church, we're all David's family members. So we're going to pray for David as well in just a second. Anyone else, church? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, you heard us just a second ago, and I know you heard us because I know you and you know me. And your son that you sent said that you were in him, he was in us, we are in this together. And you have told us wherever two or more meet in any one person, wherever two more of us meet in any one subject that we agree on, that you would be there as well. And we're talking about healing, Lord. And you know far more about it than we do. We've got two people that have coronavirus, Lisa and Robert. We've got a mom that has a stroke and probably brain issues. We've got our brother David that is fighting a multitude of things. Father, first we give to you the glory that it was not what we had feared, but it's still tough enough that we need the time and the doctors and the care. So, Father, for David and for Melanie and for Gracie, for Ursula and Pablo, for Dan and Betty, for David, for Susan, Jairus and Jessica, Father, all of these need your touch as we are struggling with family and friends and neighbors and their distress. Let us not be timid in this time. Let us lift our prayers to you in the knowledge that they will be heard. And in your time, Lord, you will see that they are acting upon as with your will. Father, we thank you. We love you, Father, and we praise you and we worship you because you alone are worthy. And all God's children said, amen and amen. Church, you know that we're not passing the buckets, the plates, and they're in place somewhere there. If your tithe is prepared, if you would leave it there, take your heart and leave your prayer there as well, that in the coming months we will be able to continue to move through this and to come out on the other side financially and health and all the above. Now it's time to sing my most favorite song. I love this song. We could call this a praise chorus, couldn't we? Back before there was a praise chorus. Miss Liz, stand as you're able.
Like to remain standing, join us on page 529 for our second hymn, How Firm a Foundation. Thank you.
know about you, church. That was some theology right there. Anybody notice? See those apprentices? Is that what they're called? Two little things? Fear not, I am with thee. Oh, be not dismayed, for I am thy God and will still give thee aid. When through the deep waters I call thee to go, the rivers of woe shall not thee overflow. Come on. When through fiery trials thy pathway shall lie, my grace all sufficient shall be thy supply. My grace all sufficient. That means for everything. Every sin, every mistake. That's what my grace all sufficient means. There's good stuff in the hymns, amen? Even if I don't know how to sing the melody, I know how to read the words. Read the words, church. Amen? Amen. Okay. I'm off my soapbox. Preaching's over. Y'all know that's a fib. Church, last Sunday was the first Sunday of Advent. Advent happens every year right about this same time. Year in, year out. Advent, why? I hadn't missed an Advent in, I don't know how long. 25, 30 years. And I was in church last Sunday, so I had no excuse. I'm sure other churches were having Advent, but I blinked and I missed it. I blinked and I missed it. Who would have thought? The truth of the matter is, I'm a bit distracted in life. I am. I'm telling you the truth. I was thinking about other matters all last Sunday. I was thinking about giving thanks. That was what was in my heart last Sunday. That was what was most important to me, was that we could come and agree that we should all be giving thanks. We all have so much to be thankful for. And you joined right with me, and I was so thankful for that. I still missed the first Sunday of Advent. I'm not sure. There's probably something in the Book of Discipline. I get five black marks and a discredit, and I've got to do something. I don't know. But I missed it so that we would spend time giving thanks. And I said that I'm going to say it again because I was really proud. Not a single one of you came up and said, "Hey, did you forget something?" Because I surely did. And you know what? They say that John Wesley never published a single, and he published all his stuff, a single Christmas sermon. What do you think about that? That kind of threw me aside for a minute until I realized that during the 1600s and 1700s, Wesley preaching in the 1700s, it wasn't a Christmas church Christmas. Matter of fact, churches were against the celebration of Christmas in the church because it was a secular holiday. Now, so that would kind of, I think, give John Wesley a reason for not preaching a Christmas sermon. They would have thrown him out of the church at the time. Isn't that hard to believe? It wasn't even until 1870 in the United States, Christmas was not even a legal holiday. And certainly not a church holiday. But all of that together, missing Advent, being I don't know if I'm depressed, just struggling, trying to keep up, just like everybody is. You know, you get so tired of this whole stuff. So I'm going to tell you right now, I might have gone a little far off a beam last Sunday. For the second Sunday of Advent, thank you, Vince, and thank you for volunteering. We're moving toward that. But just before I really get into this, I'm going to read some scripture in a minute. We're going to talk about it, and it's important. And understand this. I love Christmas. I love it. Yep, I love it. I never get tired of Christmas songs. I can hear a million of them. I love Christmas. But if you hear nothing else this morning, church, understand in the Christian faith, cannot be Christmas without Christ.
Amen.
We can go to Christmas and leave Christ out of it, but that is not a Christian celebration. So don't get me wrong, I'm not bah humbugging you, but I am going to give you information just for a second, and then I'll jump back into this. The Advent wreath, as we know it, first started out in Germany and the Scandinavian countries. It wasn't even a wreath. For eons, people had been bringing greenery into their house in the winter, and they'd put it around their windows and on the shelves and everything to keep the evil spirits away. But as church progressed, they started using candles to mark the time before Christmas. They didn't have it in the church, but in people's homes, they would have greenery laid out, and they would have four candles. Colors didn't matter. They weren't the candles we use today. And you'd light one candle the first week, and the second week you'd light two, just like we do in the tradition that we follow, and on through those 30 days before Christmas. And for them, they used it as a way to mark time. How many more weeks before Christmas? Well, let's count the candles. But they also used it, and this is so important, that every week the lights get brighter because there's more candles, amen? To signify the coming, if you will, of the one true light. Amen?
Amen.
Now, here's the part that gets me. After a while, some church person decided, well, we need to have that in church. And you know, if it's going to be in church, it needs to be ornamental, and it needs to match the church decor. And so they came, and they made a wreath. That was, you know, and they said, well, let's get colored candles that match the pyramids and everything, so it all matches. And the church supply stores, those people like Cokesbury is to us, or in any denomination supply store, they started making special candles and special colors. And then somebody said, well, it's not enough just to mark time. We need to give them significance. And so we made something bigger than it ever had intended to be, and there's nothing wrong with that. It's just showing, it's funny, when man gets a hold of things, we got to be able to figure that out and make it fit our decisions and our finances. So all of the church supply stores started selling big, pretty candles, and they were purple and blue and matched the pyramids. And week one, you know, we say is hope. And that's a wonderful thing to say. Week two is love. Week three is joy. Joy unstoppable. And week four is peace. So I said that to say this, church. We've got John Wesley not preaching a church sermon because it's a secular holiday, not a church holiday at that time. But you know what Charles did? He didn't even slow down. He wrote church Christmas poems as fast as he could write. Two of them we sing even today. And I could not even think about having Christmas without having those two songs. Do y'all know what they are? Anybody? Name one. Hark the Herald, Angels Sing. How many times have you sung that in your life or listened to it? Tons? Okay, come on, guys. I'm going to talk longer the less you respond. Thank you. And he did not write those original words. It was like, hark the yelican. I don't know even what that word was. But they adapted it and put it into song form, and it is attributed to Charles Wesley. Doesn't it just make you feel like Christmas when you hear, hark the herald angels sing glory to the newborn king? What does it say? It says, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. That's us and him, church. That's some good stuff. You know, the other one that he wrote hundreds, but matter of fact, Charles Wesley was the most prolific writer. He didn't write hymns, he wrote poems. But when they put them to music, they became hymns. He was the most prolific Christian writer, period. Hundreds and hundreds of poems and songs. But you know, the one that I love the most, and it's all about Advent. Come thou long expected Jesus. Come thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people free. From our fears and sins release us. Let us find our rest in thee. Okay, church, that's my Advent and my Christmas. We're going to get into a lot more as we come. I wanted to share that with you. And, you know, I can't shade the blame. I can't blame anybody but myself. But I keep trying for the scripture. We are in Matthew today, 1:18 through 2, somewhere 12 to 13. We may get a little further. Hear the word. The birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife. For the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel. Oh, I love that name. Which means God is with us. Excuse me. When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife, but had no marital relations with her until she had borne a son, and he named him Jesus. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage. When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and the scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet. And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah are by no means least amongst the rulers of Judah. For from you shall become a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel. Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." He was lying. We know that. When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of him went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. And entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother. And they knelt down and paid him homage. Then opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. The word of God for the people of God. I don't know what this says to you, church, but I know what it is saying to me. First and foremost, how amazing is it that when this happened and when people came together, they espoused prophecy from hundreds of years ago. That pretty much amazes me. We don't seem to have that anymore, do we? No one telling us what is going to happen in the next millennium. We can't find anyone to give us a good telling of what's going on right now with the disease. Where did it really come from? Was it from a bat? Was it from? Nobody knows. Or if they do, they're not telling it. And then again, when the prophets spoke, and you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people, Israel. I wish I had about an hour on this morning, church. I really do. And I wish we were all sitting around with a cup of coffee and we could really, like when David teaches Bible, we could get into that. Because you see, I am a bit bah humbug when we get Christmas mixed up. Because there's two Christmases, right? One's Christmas for all the retailers and the young kids, and Santa Claus is coming to town and giving gifts for one another and eating big meals. That's a good Christmas. It's a lot of fun. We're going to the mountains this year, and we'll have everybody up there, and it's going to be a great time. But I ask you this, what's Christmas without Christ? And how do we balance those two things? Because, you know, through the Bible, we are told time and time again that we are to be peaceful with the authorities, right? Whose figure is on that denarius? Well, it's Caesar's. Give unto Caesar those things that are Caesar's, and render to God those things that are God's. So all through it, we're told to obey the authorities, go with the cultural aspects of the nation. But could we have Christmas without Christ? If I showed up next Sunday in a Santa Claus outfit, little extra padding maybe, and sit here out front and ask each of you to come and sit on my knee and say, "Tell me now, Liz, what do you want for Christmas?" And I listened to every one of you. I even wrote it down so I wouldn't forget. I don't care how much faith you got in me, y'all not getting what you ask. Because Santa Claus was not even Santa Claus. It was me in a padded outfit. I have never in my life thought even for a second to run to the shopping mall and find me a Santa Claus so that I could pray to Santa Claus for someone's health. Don't think it would do much good. Have I brought that point home? I love Christmas. I love Santa Claus. I do. Ho, ho, ho. Is that the Green Giant or is that Santa Claus? You know, I love it. I love the songs. I love it. A Christmas Eve service is so near and dear to me. When we are standing here together, candles lighted, and we are singing Silent Night, it doesn't get any better to me than that. That is Christmas for me. But somewhere along the line, we've allowed it to be shanghaied and waylaid. And somewhere along the line, we have bought into this as a culture. And somewhere along the line, we made the biggest mistake of our life. So just make sure that we're all understanding. Santa Claus, amen, Christ. The two are not the same. They can live together, but never mistake one for the other. That sounds pretty simple, doesn't it, church? How many of you have worried more about, you don't have to raise your hand. How many of you have worried more about Christmas dinner than about Christ? Not that you should worry about Christ. But my family, thankfully they don't let me do the cooking. My family bakes a cake every Christmas. Not just any cake, a birthday cake. And we sing Happy Birthday to Jesus every Sunday, every Christmas. Not every Sunday, I'd be twice as big. But. And Happy Birthday, Jesus. I thought that was a little strange the first time that Melanie and Hannah and David introduced that into our household. I thought it was cool. But over the years, I've come to see the significance. If you can't sit at your Thanksgiving table and give thanks to the one that helped you endure this year up to this time, how can you sit at your Christmas table and still not give thanks to the one who makes Christmas what it should be? You know what we used to say? Jesus. He's the reason for the season. Amen? Amen? Do you still believe it? Do you know that as a country church, we're a secular country now. They have taken us off the list as a Judeo-Christian country. More people say they don't believe than do believe, so now they call us a secular country. I don't care what they call it. We're not a secular church. We are followers of Christ, children of God, and each of us is a temple for the Holy Spirit. Amen? Keep Christ in Christmas. And once again, don't take this as a bah humbug. I love Christmas. We'll be eating Christmas candy soon and cakes and pies and all of that. But you know what? Christmas for me will take place right here in this church Christmas Eve when I hold my candle up and we have each come together and shared the light with one another till all of our candles are lighted. Are we going to be able to do that, Jessica? Amen. Got to check with the compliance officer. Church, you should find this on your seat. You know, the next best thing to Christmas that I'm waiting for is the moment when we can go back to having communion the way it was meant to be. While y'all are struggling with these little dealy daubers, is anybody mad at me for being... Now remember, I said I wasn't Bah Humbug. Because if you're mad at me, I'm going to ask you to confess. Amen? To confess. I want you to repeat after me, church. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Would you take just a second, church, and pray silently from where you're sitting? Reach out, give thanks, talk to God in this moment of silence. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Now say that back to me. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. It was just a couple of weeks ago when we came to lay hands on David that I shared with you how that ceremony is much, part of it is much like communion, where we have to have confession and pardon before we partake. And that's what we just did. You confessed before the Lord, and you, through the grace of God and His Word, can stand assured that He has forgiven you. And how often did He say, go forward and sin and no more? When Jesus had the disciples in the upper room, He took the bread and He broke the bread and He gave it to them. And after praying over it, He gave it to them and said, eat of this, all of you, for this is my body broken for you. As well, when the dinner was done, He took the cup. And He said, after giving thanks to the Lord and praying over the wine, He said, drink of this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant. Do this as often as you will in remembrance of me. I can't help doing that without thinking about a good old Methodist, Mr. Welch. Welch's grape juice. He was Methodist. Church, it was a different sermon this morning, wasn't it? A little different stuff, a little different look. But it comes down to the one thing that we all have to agree on. Keep Christ in the center of everything that we do. Every time I do marriage premarital counseling, I'm preaching that put Christ in between the two of you and things will go better, and they will. Church, I want to ask one thing from you from now till Christmas Eve. Just take the things that we were discussing today. You can't have Christmas without Christ. He loves you more than you'll ever know. And he will never forget you or forsake you. And I'm going to ask that you let that rest on your hearts and in your minds. And this week, show the sermon. Show them the sermon. And I don't mean go get my notes and hold it up to them. They couldn't make anything out of it anyway. I've confused myself half the time. I'm talking about the way you live, the way you act, the way you celebrate. If you're in Walmart, if you're in the doctor's office, wherever that might be, let your life show the sermon that you live. Amen?
Amen.
And amen. Miss Jessica?
We're going to close worship today. It's on page 219 with What Child Is This? As we kind of get into our Advent season.
Jessica only halfway told a fib. She did. She's right. We were going to end worship there. Thousands of years ago, when the wise men and the shepherds and the kings came to visit the Christ baby, they came showering him with gifts. You notice they didn't stop along the way and go, yeah, before we get there, let me give you a little something. They didn't think once about exchanging gifts with each other, because the greatest gift of their life was born in Bethlehem. And they showered that child with gold, myrrh, frankincense, the greatest values that they had. Come to a baby in a manger and laid it down. So the story goes. This Christmas, church, when your grandchildren, children, and each other, when you're opening your presents and you're giving your presents, be joyous in doing that, in the giving and receiving of presents. But church, please, I ask you, when you're giving out the presents, P-R-E-S-E-N-T-S, present, give God the greatest gift of all. Your presence. P-R-E-S-E-N-C-E. Did I spell that right? Be present for Christ. That's the greatest gift you can give. Pray with me, church. Father God, we are so thankful to be with you today. And our presence here today, coming together to hear about you and to worship you, we give to you gratefully, gladly. We give you our lives, Lord. And Father, as we go through this season, never for one second let you be out of our minds or away from our hearts. Let us be joyful and enjoy our families and be thankful that we have gotten this far through the pandemic, Lord, and all of that. But never let you leave our presence. Be with us and guide us. We ask this in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And all God's children said, amen. And amen. Bless you, church. Have a great week. We are a matter of weeks from Christmas Eve. We will do Christmas Eve here. We are working now. We're probably going to have to ask people to register so we know you're coming. I don't know. What do we think? Socially distanced and where we have, we could put 50 in here? 40 or 50. If we could put 50, we're going to say 40, okay? So, right, and because there are going to be some people that just show up, and we hate to turn anybody away, but it's going to be a tough time for us, and we're going to be masked up, and we're going to do temperatures, we're going to do all the above, but it's going to be Christmas Eve, and we're going to do it together, amen? Amen. Have a great week, and God bless you.